one evening, I would like to tell you a little bit about two scientists. So we heard a lot of stories about supernovae, about stars, how they are, not really how they're born, but how they die, and what happens afterwards, and what happens to the particles around them. What happens to, we heard about these particles that we know of, about particles that we don't know of. Actually, we don't know if they are actually there or not. So we heard a lot about very abstract things. But it was very interesting to hear about it from actual living scientists that are really doing the research about them. I would like to end the evening to mentioning two scientists who led the foundations, let's say, for both these fields, for pulsars, which we heard through Edith, and dark matter, which we just heard about from Daniele. So the first one is called Jocelyn Bell. Jocelyn Bell Burnell. She was born in 1943 in Northern Ireland, and she learned about astronomy through her father's book and wanted to study physics and science, but it was very difficult at that time in Ireland. So her parents had to send her to boarding school, and eventually she went on to study physics at Glasgow and eventually at Cambridge, where she did her PhD. She started her PhD in 1965, and during her PhD she helped build this radio telescope, which is like the predecessor to what we heard about from David in the first talk. So it's a big dish that looks for radio waves that are coming from outer space. So she helped build this telescope, which was built to study quasars, which are very interesting objects in the universe that we know are galaxies that are hosting a supermassive black hole at their center, which is doing very crazy things, as Abby told us about. So they wanted to study quasars with this big radio telescope. And shortly after the telescope started operating in 1967, Jocelyn was a PhD student, so she was analyzing the data. And the data was arriving on very large paper sheets. Actually, every 4 days they would produce 120 meters of paper. And she was analyzing all the readings from the telescope, which were printed on paper. So 120 meters is a few blocks. And then she noticed something very strange. So she noticed this strange oscillations, which were very fast. Too fast and too regular to be a quasar, which is the object that they were studying. It took only a very small piece of the 120 meter paper, but she spotted that, and jokingly, because they didn't understand this phenomenon, they called it LGM number one. And LGM stands for Little Grey Man. Because it was such a bizarre event that they didn't know how to explain, they thought maybe it's. They didn't think it's the aliens out there, but you can never exclude that option. And then eventually some other theorists, Thomas Gold and Fred Hoyle, realized that this signal was actually coming from a pulsar, which is a rotating neutron star, like what Abby explained us earlier. And this pulsar, so a pulsar, because it has it emits beams of light and it spins, so you only see the beam of light every time it crosses the line that you're looking at. If you're lucky enough that it's aligned in such a way that you can spot it, so it appears like that. Now it's here, now it's not, now it's here, now it's not, but that's because the whole thing is spinning. That's called a pulsar because it's seen as a pulsating object. This one especially was called PSRB1919 plus 21. Maybe some of you, the less young in the crowd, might have seen a signal on the cover of a record some time ago. Can you maybe go to the next slide again? So actually Joy Division for the signal of this very bizarre object on their first record in 79. In 1974, Anthony Hewish, who was Jocelyn Bell's supervisor, and Martin Ryle got the Nobel Prize for the discovery of pulsars. And Jocelyn didn't because she was a student. She continued happily her physics career. She was appointed professor of physics in the 70s. Her appointment meant that the number of female professors in the UK doubled. quite simple. And then she worked for a very long while at the Open University, which is pioneering educational institution in the UK that also allowed people to take degrees and study remotely. So she is still she retired from active research, but she is still very very much present in the astronomy community. So that's the first astronomer that I just wanted to mention, because maybe you've heard of pulsars, maybe you haven't, but now you've also heard of Jocelyn Bell. The second person, you might have heard of her, because unfortunately she passed away last Christmas. She's called Vera Rubin. She was an American scientist. She was the daughter of Jewish immigrants from Eastern Europe, and she was very determined to study astronomy. She was born in 1928. She was not allowed at a number of places because she was a woman. For example, she couldn't get into Princeton. Then eventually she went to Vassar and Cornell and Georgetown, and she completed her PhD in Georgetown under George Gamow, who was a very, very interesting physicist of the past century, discovered a lot of interesting things about the universe. And Vera, in her PhD, she studied the distribution of galaxies, how galaxies are distributed in the universe, because, okay, we don't see a lot of galaxies. If we look at the night sky, we actually can see one if we are very, very good at spotting it. But if you take a long exposure with telescopes, you would see that there is a lot of galaxies, but they are not distributed randomly, they're actually clumps, and their distribution can tell us a lot of things about the history of the universe. So Vera started her, after her PhD, she became a staff astronomer, and she started taking spectra of galaxies. So a spectrum is when you split light into its different colors, different wavelengths. And that is a way that it's one of the ways that you can use to measure an object's speed in space, so a star or a star in a galaxy. So taking the spectra of stars in nearby galaxies, Vera Rubin started to study the motion of stars in these galaxies. And what she found is that stars were moving in a very, very unexpected way. So close to the center, they were moving quite fast, as you would expect. And then you expect that further and further away they would move slower, but they didn't. What she was studying is our neighbor, the Andromeda galaxy, or M31. And you would expect, so this is a plot of the velocity that you expect of stars, and you expect that, okay, in the center they move quite fast because there's a lot of, they feel a lot of gravity from the whole galaxy. But then further and further away, you would expect this curve to go down, and it doesn't. This is exactly what I was talking about, and what Daniele was talking about earlier. So what do you expect from the amount of stuff that we see there is in a galaxy? You would expect the stars further away from the center move really, really slow. But they don't. So we assume that there must be something else that we don't see. The dark matter that Daniele and his very crazy colleagues are looking for in very strange ways. Vera Rubin was not the first one to suggest that dark matter exists. It was suggested by various other scientists since the beginning of the 20th century. But her observations of many galaxies in which this phenomenon is observed was the first convincing evidence that something else must be there. Either we don't understand how gravity works, or there must be something else. And yes, as we heard with Daniele, dark matter is still undetected, but we are looking, and many people are looking for it across the world, and Vera Rubin created a whole new field of research. So I'm happy that now I could also share her story.
Thank you.
Thanks again. That was Sarah Clamant on violin solo. Thank you all for coming again, for being here. If you want to stay up to date with future events like this, you may leave your email at the entrance. There's some paper, or you may follow the Facebook group Science Arts Slam. Let's thank again our two speakers. If you'd like to come on stage once more, Abby, David, and Daniela. And Sarah, Paul, Renato, Andrea, and Vicky, thank you all.